Lovely, Dr. Salusi and the Honorable Cabinet Ministers and distinguished life members, the President of the Association, distinguished speakers and colleagues. Thank you very much for this opportunity to talk a little bit about Fiji's approach to climate change and health. I'm very grateful today that with the invitations that the Association has sent to the Honorable Ministers, we now have an idea what's happening in the global stage and why we need to champion climate change. And for somebody who's been in theater for quite a while and naive to all this, it really woke me up when I came outside and saw the sun and saw the rising sea level. And I was told by my colleagues how bad we are, you know, obviously globally. I'm also very grateful that, you know, we began to understand from what the infrastructure challenges are. Because certainly some of you, you know, we work in institutions, we work also in some Ministry of Health facilities that are under threat. And it's important for us to understand the challenges are not only limited to the Ministry of Health facilities, but all over the country. I'm also grateful that we've heard about the challenges that women and young girls and also the marginalized face in climate change, because as a government we certainly believe in gender mainstreaming and supporting the cause of our women. 67% of Ministry of Health employees are women, and we have to understand the fact, I have to understand the fact that in a few years time when I need to get my prostate checked, it will be a woman consultant urologist. And I have to also accept the fact that you know, when I probably need my hip replaced, it will be a senior orthopedic woman surgeon, because that's where we are heading. So I think as an organization, we need to accept that gender mainstreaming is part and parcel of what we do and also in the service we provide. Those are some of the things I want to talk about. I'll be very short, for about 10 minutes. We'll just keep on going back. The Lancet report, which was came out at the end of 2018, basically talked about four key messages in climate change and health. Number one, it's compounded and overwhelming. It's like a synergistic, bacterial infection. 1 + 1 = 4. That's what's happening at the moment in the world. It's 1 + 1 = 4. It's compounded and it's an overwhelming impact, because the temperatures continue to rise. We've heard about it. The thing is, there's a lack of progress in reducing emissions and building the adaptive capacity. And the minister has talked about how we need to mitigate and also adapt and transform all at the same time, whereas developed countries will talk about layers as you go along. Also, thirdly, they talked about the nature and the scale of response will be the determining factor. So as a Ministry of Health, we're working very hard in that space to respond. One of the first responses that we've done is to get FEMET certified as WHO EMT certified, the 15th nation in the world. We are the 15th nation in the world and the first small island development state. Okay? So we need to adapt and adapt very quickly. And we also have to understand that climate change is a central public health threat, and we need an accelerated response. The global evidence on the impact of climate change and health, it talks about climate change threatening human health, and that's why some of the discussions that I've had, I've talked about climate change actually threatening our very survival. The challenge are the challenges to proper shelter, clean air and water, adequate water supply and nutritious food. And the pathways are complex, but basically we have primary, which are illnesses. So you know, if you got a heat stroke, if you go outside, it's very hot, you can get a heat stroke. So that's primary. A lot of it is secondary. So you know, we've had a flood, and then you get disease outbreaks. There's poor water quality, decreasing crop yields, so food security becomes limited. And then tertiary, because of relocation, mental stress. And climate change and mental health is now becoming a talked about issue. Recently, we had the 7th Asia-Pacific Parliamentary Forum, which was held in Nandi, to review the progress of countries towards developing and implementing policies to achieve health through the Sustainable Development Goals, but also share experiences. And I want to share some of the experiences that we had. The Philippines is going through some real struggles at the moment. They're struggling with HIV/AIDS. It's estimated that 1 in 100 people in the Philippines are at risk from tuberculosis. At the moment, they're struggling with dengue. This is a country that actually had it all together about 20 years ago. Okay, and they still are better than us in terms of as a developed country. But what I'm trying to share here with us today is that we have to be consistent in our approach. Because if we're not, then we can get overwhelmed again with the struggles that come with climate change and the shifting focus of climate change and health. So I want us to have a look at this graph, which shows how countries can prepare for health impacts of climate change. And I want us to see that right on this side towards your right, if you don't adapt very quickly, you can collapse or you can recover, but you're worse off than before. Tropical cyclone Winston decimated 25% of our GDP. Just before that, the tropical cyclone, what was it in Vanuatu, Dr. Luke? Pem in Vanuatu, that decimated about 40 to 50% of the GDP. Okay? I'm not trying to be, biased towards Fiji today, but Vanuatu is still struggling. Why? Because we've taken it upon ourselves, we're going to adapt very quickly. And the government poured a lot of resources into making the infrastructure changes, into building schools, into making sure that all that hospitals and health centers that got affected were again put up, they were put up again. Okay, so it's about making sure. So you're going to be hit. We're going to be hit. Okay, the challenge comes. So we've got to absorb the shock. We are vulnerable, but what is resilience? Resilience is, decreased vulnerability plus increased capacity. Okay, so we decrease our vulnerability because we prepare for it. We increase our capacity to cope with it. And hopefully, we will be right at the top. We'll transform. You understand? So that is our hope. The hope is that when we get hit again, we will transform rather than being worse off than before. In the Western Pacific region, the populations are a threat by extreme weather patterns. And waterborne and vector-borne disease is a huge problem. In Tuvalu, recently they had 500 people hit. That was last month. I don't know about today. Last month, as of last month, 500 people had dengue. There's only 12,000 people in Tuvalu. Out of that 500 people, two died. We had 2,500 people with dengue, only one died. Remember, in 2006, we had 30,000 Fijians had dengue, and 16 died. 2012, we had nearly 15,000 people with dengue. Okay? The environmental health officers are working the field. They've also released the Wolbachia mosquitoes. Okay? There's a lot of work going behind the scene. And I want us to understand that we need to remember that communicable disease is as important as non-communicable disease in the setting that we are in. The chief health advisor to the United Kingdom National Health Service, when she wrote a report, this is what she said. She said, undeveloped and developed nations, if they do not think about communicable disease and put all their eggs into the basket of NCD, when they get hit by a climate change disaster, then they will have no resources to deal with communicable disease. So, most of us like to think about NCD, but we have to remember that climate change affects both NCD and also communicable disease. This is the graph that the ministers were talking about. If you look at Fiji, our emissions is actually very low, and it's always remained low. Other countries around the Pacific are emitting higher than us. But overall, the Pacific, overall, we're not emitting as high as the world standard. But even though we are a low world emitter of carbon, we continue to pursue best practice. This is another interesting graph. If you look at 1976, right, they had a number of events, which was storms, floods, and droughts in Pacific Island countries. There was about the number of events, about 10. Total affected persons was less. If you look compared to 2011 and to 2019, you can see that the number of events is getting more, but also recently the number of affected people is also more. This is because the storms, droughts, the cyclones are getting stronger and the intensity is more. Okay, and it's hitting the populations. You know, for example, tropical cyclone Winston was actually on its path to hit Suva. You know, so the paths that the cyclone normally go before, they're not following anymore. And the older people in the room will tell you that the normal path would come through Vanuatu, go through maybe a little bit towards Asawa, then head southwest sort of thing, Kadabu, then go. But they're not following those paths anymore. Tropical cyclone winds, they went past us. Honorable Minister for Defense, he was the Minister for Disaster. He will tell you the story that he gave a brief to the Honorable Prime Minister. He said, "Sir, the cyclone has already passed us." And then he got a shock when he looked at the radar the next day. He was in the Philippines or somewhere, sir, that he actually turned and was coming back towards Fiji. So you can see it's beginning to go towards the populations that normally didn't go to before. $33 billion worth for small island development states in terms of the cost for the disasters. The potential drivers in Fiji are air pollution, deforestation, emission of greenhouse gases, agriculture, landfills. For example, the landfills, they may emit methane, and the natural wetlands. And the impact of climate change, you have a primary impact, okay, which is like the acute trauma. You have a secondary impact, which is people getting, you know, the vector-borne diseases and so forth. And the tertiary impact, where later on you can have a landslide where you have to change infrastructure and so forth. Now, I want to just talk a little bit about this. Communicable disease is a threat, remains a threat. We need to work in both spaces because climate change is threatening both. So for NCD, it's food security. It's about, rising sea levels. So if you're able to go walk around the beach, you can't walk around the beach anymore because of that. So we need to work around NCD. We also need to work around communicable disease. I've given the health inspectors and the public health team led by Dr. Alicia Challenge, I said, reduce, look to eradicate dengue, leptospirosis, typhoid, and diarrhea. We also have an approach. We have the National Climate Change Policy, the Fiji National Adaptation Plan Framework, and our Minister of Health and Medical Services Climate Change and Health Unit, which responds to in response to our national commitments. I can share those with you later. There are four important things: empowerment, the evidence, the implementation, and the resources. Recently, Kweka has been talking to us about giving us some money around doing projects around climate change. So we're looking at how we can improve our public health labs. We've had WHO support and the FEMAT that we've been talking about. So the way forward is we need to encourage the adaptation of climate change and health strategic action plans. We strengthen the mainstreaming of climate change into our Ministry of Health development projects and plan and programs, and the expansion of the current early warning systems to incorporate statistical analysis and capabilities. So what we're looking at is going towards very soon with our public health lab. For example, if there's been some rainfall up in the Nandi, Nosori Highlands, which is above Nandi, and it reaches a certain threshold that we measured it, we can then begin to predict if there's going to be a dengue outbreak and when it will happen around the greater Nandi area. That's where we're heading now in terms of public health. Thank you very much.